like to begin off by acknowledging the traditional owners on the land on which we meet, not only the Ngunnawal and the Gambri peoples, but at this international conference, all the First Peoples throughout Australia, and recognise their continuing connection to land, waters and culture, and pay my respects to their elders, past, present and emerging. Indeed, among other things, we are here to discuss the lack of respect we as contemporary Australians have shown not only to those who can trace their belonging to this land back thousands of years, but to our own elders, the senior Australians, who include our parents or grandparents or indeed our siblings, other near relatives and friends. Well, in September last year, Scott Morrison, as the newly installed Prime Minister, he'd only been in the job about 4 weeks, announced he was establishing a royal commission into the aged care sector, which would also encompass those who are drawn into it, like the young disabled, who are consigned to aged care facilities for lack of anywhere else appropriate for them. The first hearing of the royal commission was in Adelaide in February of this year. Adelaide, no doubt, was chosen because it was the site of one of the more egregious examples of the neglect and abuse of the infirm aged. The South Australian-run aged care facility, Oakden, was closed after horrific evidence of elder abuse and neglect emerged through the media. In announcing the Royal Commission, Scott Morrison was at pains to point out that the problems were not restricted to any one part of the aged care sector. He said, whether it's for profit or not for profit, large or small facilities, regional or major metropolitan. But I think it's important to remember the political context of this announcement. Morrison's immediate political problem at the time, remember, this is ahead of an election where the opinion polls had relentlessly predicted that the warring Liberals were going to lose. His political problem then was that by arrangement with the states going back a long time, aged care was funded by the Commonwealth, whereas hospital care is the purview of the states. The policies and funding regulating aged care in Australia are predominantly, if not exclusively, the domain of Canberra, where the states may, as in Oakden, have aged care facilities. They're few and far between, and they're still mostly funded by the Commonwealth and bound by the Commonwealth's regulations and protocols. Well, Morrison, when he was Treasurer, signed off two key budget changes. There's a lot of political argument about this, even in the last sitting weeks of Parliament of this session this year. He signed off on two budget changes that shaved $2 billion from growth forecasts for what's called the Aged Care Funding Instrument. This is the device the federal government uses to allocate funding. So as blame began to mount, with further revelations on television news and current affairs shows, especially the ABC, announcing a royal commission was seen by many as a time-buying exercise. And a dramatic marketing of a message that the new kid on the block, the new Prime Minister, intends to do something better with the $20 billion a year the government pumps into this sector. And it's handy to remember, just going back to the context we're talking about, that Morrison in fact announced the Royal Commission a day ahead of the ABC's Four Corners program going to air, with what it was promoting as dramatic new evidence of bashings and neglect in nursing homes. So there's a lot of political discussion and argument about how bad minority government is, or a government with only a majority of one, how unstable and all of that. But I have a slightly different view here. From the point of view of accountability and political pressure, there's a lot to be said for having a minority government fearing for its survival and desperate to cauterise its many self-inflicted political simply, Morrison didn't have the time to be dragged kicking and screaming to this Royal Commission, as was the case with the Banking Royal Commission. In fact, the Prime Minister made a virtue of his predicament, saying he had learned from his experience of opposing the Banking Royal Commission for so long. And of course, there's another stark reality playing into the politics of this Royal Commission, and that is our ageing population. The Australian Medical Association, the AMA, in its submission to the Royal Commission said, Australia's health and aged care systems are currently not keeping pace with the needs of its older people. Australia's population is ageing. In 2017, 15% of the population, or 3.8 million, was aged 65 years and over. By 2057, not all that far away, the proportion of older people is expected to rise to 22%, or 8.8 million. But in fact, already, as we see from those figures, grey power is a significant voting cohort. And with a looming tight election, you want to keep as many voters on side as you can. And, as luck would have it, there was another political opportunity at play for Morrison. The Labor Party had kindly decided to address the burgeoning unaffordability of a dividend imputation loophole. Let me try to explain. It's a complicated matter, but it amounts to the government giving shareholders a credit on the income tax already paid by the companies they've invested in. The loophole meant these credits could exceed the amount of tax concession the investor was entitled to claim. And you may remember Labor, in trying to contain the $6 billion a year cost of this loophole to the revenue, and it is growing, made the argument, why should people who haven't paid the tax get a cash refund? However, in the hands of its political opponents, the government, this Labor policy and a couple of others was portrayed as an attack on older Australians and their modest investments in equities. This also fed into a social media onslaught, and I understand this will be one of the findings of Labor's review of the election loss, just how effective social media was for the Liberals in the campaign. Well, this social media onslaught accused Labor of wanting to reintroduce death taxes and threaten the ability of older Australians to leave anything to their children. It was a perfect political storm. So whatever dereliction of duty the Liberal government might be accused of in regard for caring for the aged, Labor was worse because it was going to bury them in penury. Now, the rest is history, as they say. But now the government has been miraculously returned. God clearly votes Liberal. Time is ticking down for Morrison in terms of keeping faith with older voters and their families. The Prime Minister is promising to take the recommendations of the Royal Commission very seriously. In fact, he said so just a couple of weeks back. Last year, when he announced he was establishing the Royal Commission, however, he refused to agree there was a crisis in aged care. In fact, a couple of months earlier, he accused Labor of fear-mongering over the aged care issue. And that was despite, by the way, the government already receiving and largely ignoring the 38 recommendations of what was called the Aged Care Legislative Review, handed to it in 2017 by Richard Tune. And in the same year, the Carnell-Patterson report into the aged care sector after the horrible revelations in the Oakden scandal. Well, the Royal Commission's interim report will be released on Thursday of this week. According to one of the commissioners, Linnell Briggs, it'll be largely the work of Richard Tracy QC, the chairman who died while writing it. She says Tracy labelled aspects of the aged care system cruel and unkind after two particularly grueling days of evidence in Darwin. And I think that this probably gives us more than a hint of what the recommendations might look like on Thursday. Commissioner Briggs told a commission hearing after Tracy's death a couple of weeks back, "It was Richard who encouraged me to drive our policy agenda beyond change at the margin to transformative change." And this was in light of the degree of substandard care that was apparent to us. So we wait to see what the transformative recommendations will look like, but we know they can't come cheaply. And without a dramatic cultural change that puts people before profits and entrenched institutional indifference, it'll be shameful if it's business as usual. The AME and the Australian Nurses Federation in their recommendations to the Royal Commission said the situation was too dire for the government to wait until the extended final reporting deadline of November next year. The fact is, the government already knows the essential reasons for the crisis: inadequate funding and weak enforcement of standards composed by inadequate funding and weak enforcement of standards compounded by the biggest providers being listed on the stock exchange. That means they are obliged in law to put shareholders' interests ahead of patients' interests. The Royal Commission has so far received close to 7,000 submissions. But the government's Aged Care Quality and Safety Commission, through its accreditation reports, has already documented an appalling situation. The ABC analysed the accreditation reports of the British multinational provider Bupa. Bupa is Australia's largest private for-profit provider. Of Bupa's 72 nursing homes, 45 have failed to meet the health and safety standards. 22 homes have been declared as putting the health and safety of residents at, quote, serious risk. 13 Bupa homes have been sanctioned, which means they've lost government funding and are unable to take new residents. But the sad reality is those sanctions are quickly lifted, and have been. The political potency of the issue is not hard to appreciate. The television reports and their hidden camera images have brought out into broad daylight what we hitherto were relieved to keep hidden behind closed doors. Death and dying is something our culture tries to ignore. There are profound sociological, philosophical, and indeed theological issues at play. But the fact is, once reminded of our mortality, and seeing evidence of treatment that is meted out to others, it's not hard to conclude that could be me, or at least my loved parent or relative. AMA President Dr. Tony Bartone, in his witness statement to the Commission, said, "Any industry that is responsible for the care of another human being should be held to the highest standards. This includes the aged care system." While the new aged care quality standards that came into effect on the 1st of July this year, 2019, Dr. Bartone says, consist of important principles of respect, dignity, and engagement with older people, he says they are high level, subjective, and potentially vague. Indeed, the AMA believes the additional administration requirements are a tick box exercise that detracts from the time aged care staff have to actually care for older persons. More paperwork, less care. The AMA and others have told the Royal Commission much more funding is needed to provide mandated staffing levels, which include doctors, registered nurses, and better trained aged care attendants. Better trained, they're not trained, that's the problem. And the AMA wants government rules or conditions in place to ensure increased funding goes to patient care and not to the provider's bottom line. According to the Tax Justice Network, between them, the six largest for-profit companies were given over $2.17 billion in government subsidies, 72% of their revenue, and made profits of $219 million per year between 2016 and 2018. Here's the rub. We have a government for whom profit is not a dirty word. Welfare is. But when that profit is coming directly from the taxpayers, we have a right to ask, what the hell's going on? And there is another dirty word, and that's regulation, or red tape. So you see, red tape gets in the way of business. Now, there's already more than enough evidence to suggest the model of aged care we have in Australia is flawed. And to paraphrase another former Prime Minister, the Royal Commission cannot help but to so far.